Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway. Supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza. SliceOnBroadway.com. IndieWrestling.us. Check out IWC, RWA, and more. Click the Fight TV link on WrestlingMayhemShow.com to support this show and watch pro wrestling, MMA, boxing, and so much more. And listeners like you, support this show at Patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, episode 567. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter in the Mayhem Studio in Pittsburgh, PA, where we talk professional wrestling. This is the flagship show of, we didn't have a Mayhem shakeup yet or anything like that, but we're going to have a lot of fun tonight. Everybody's hopping in the chat room and over at live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com. With us, of course, on the couch, we got Larry watching his 205 Live.
What's up?
How's going on?
Drama.
Drama so far here, 24 minutes into 205 Live.
Yeah, man, Dr. Phil needs to get there quick.
Okay, that's not what I expected from the Cruiserweights. Also over there, Chad the Shad joins us, an OG Mayhemmer, back on the show.
Good evening. Good evening.
Okay. Thank you. On the line with us, of course, Mad Mike, the only one of the crew with a Future Endeavor letter from the WWE in Poughkeepsie, New York.
Hi, Sorg.
Did I do that backwards?
I brought Dave Bautista's co-star in Guardians of the Galaxy, Teeny Tiny Baby Groot.
Teeny Tiny Baby Groot in Lego form. Look at that. That's yes. Awesome. Also joining us, he is behind the PCW in Cleveland in the upcoming welterweight tournament. He is Joe Dombrowski, also a producer on such fine productions like Finding Zach Gowan in the Montreal Theory.
You don't mean the same productions that you could find at IndieWrestling.us,
do you? Oh, coincidentally, yes.
Well, I'll be.
Thank you so much, Joe.
Happy to be back.
Thank you so much, Joe, for joining us. So we're going to talk about what's going on with you here in a few moments. But first, please check out everything at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You can subscribe to the show on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, and video versions on the Wrestling Mayhem Show YouTube and Facebook page. Also, stay tuned to those because they have live feeds on both of those. YouTube has, of course, the WWE RAW wrap-up and the Midweek Wars, and the Facebook has some random Indy Mayhem shows throughout the week. This week later, we're going to be talking to Ray Zombie of Wrestling with Independence over on Indiegogo, and whatever else might come on here and there, like when the machines shut down or we're at intermission and talking to Joe about his a wacky fun booth of goodness over at the wrestling shows. Stay tuned to all those. And, of course, we're here at Tuesdays, 10 p.m. Eastern time for this show, the Wrestling Mayhem Show, at live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com, and whatever technology we're using will be linked up in there. Also, you can drop us a line at that email address.
Good times!
Good times at wrestlingmayhemshow.com. And you can drop us a line also at 412-206-WMS0. Put that in your phone and write in it, dial when drunk for those Friday and Saturday nights or Tuesday afternoons when you're hammered and want to let us know what wrestling's like, or right after Raw or something. That would be fun too. At Mayhem Show on the Twitter, Wrestling Mayhem Show group on Facebook, and of course thank you to our Patreon supporters at the Fan of the Show dollar level. Bo Diggity,
woo,
Ed Burke, the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment, the Trey Garcia, I don't know why I added that. Trey Gar and Bobby F. J-Town. And at the Pocky Club $5 level that gets the Mayhem Show gold is Tina Keys, Christopher Bishop, and Mad Mike, henceforth referred to as the American Kevin Owens and the Canadian Lance Catamaran. I forgot that last part was added there last
Catamaran.
Week. Catamaran. 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 Yes. Catamaran. Catamaran.
Catamaran. Catamaran.
Catman?
Catman. No.
Catman.
Catman. Kathmandu?
I am Groot.
Chattanooga.
I am Groot.
So now you need to call him Groot from now on instead of all that other stuff.
Okay. All right.
Cheese ragu, cheese souffle, pie and pudding, almond flambé.
Okay.
You know French?
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. First of all, Joe Dombrowski, thank you for joining us here on the show. We're going to talk more extensively, of course, on the Indy Mayhem Show coming up later this week. But you got a pretty special project. I know it's been kind of a pet project for a little bit here. Well, first of all, can you fill the people in just shortly? What are you doing in Cleveland?
In general, what am I doing in Cleveland?
Yeah, why Cleveland? What's happening in Cleveland these days?
Well, I have a great history in Cleveland. Anybody that may have followed me for a while knows that I produced Prime Wrestling TV, formerly PWO, for 6 years up there. And I had kind of gotten out of the front office of pro wrestling for a while, but a gentleman with a business opportunity approached me about getting back in the game up there. And we've been running Premier Championship Wrestling at Turner's Hall in Cleveland. And Turner's Hall is fitting and famous because it's where JT Lightning used to run Cleveland All Pro Wrestling. It's where Johnny Gargano and M-Dog 20 and Josh Prohibition learned to wrestle, training in the basement. AIW would run there for a couple of years, and now it's our steady home. And we've been running events there consistently since August. And the crowds have grown, and the buzz has grown. I'm very thankful for that. We've got some great talent from Pittsburgh, from Cleveland, and from Indiana, from Michigan, from New York, from all over. And now, in conjunction with that, comes my next project, Welterweight Wrestling, which is going to be a one-night survival of the fittest-type tournament with 185-pound talents and under. I thought it was a little silly. You talk about 205 live, I think it's silly that we have 205-pound athletes that have to, for lack of a better term, be in the kiddie pool when you've got 210, 215-pound guys in the main event. I don't think 205 pounds is this generation's overlooked, undersized talent. The cruiserweights are accepted now. They have a home. They deserve a home. But there's still a ton of guys out there who are still being told you're not good enough, you're not big enough, you don't have enough muscle mass, et cetera, et cetera. Let's give them a home and let's let them have their own canvas to perform on and see if we might be able to revitalize, rejuvenate, or maybe innovate a little bit of what people view as quote-unquote cruiserweight or welterweight style wrestling in 2017. So our first event's May 7th on the Fight app on iPay-Per-View, or you can join us up at Turner's, and we'll see where it goes from there. But we've got a lot of hungry talents and a lot of buzz in the air.
Yeah, go check it out again if you're in the area. And that's one of the reasons I wanted to bring it up on this show, because it's something that is widely available to everybody out there. And you can go click that Fight TV link over on WrestlingMayhemShow.com and help out this show as well when you go pick up that pay-per-view here next month on May 7th. So, like I said, we'll have a more extended discussion about what you're doing up there in welterweight wrestling, of course, on Indy Mayhem Show. So let's get into the general wrestling talk. And we were going to run a little bit of an experiment this week. So Larry has items for this week.
Yeah.
And I thought we would let him lead.
Oh dear.
As an experiment.
So I had the three top things I wanted to talk about.
I know one's probably not gonna work, but
one's probably not gonna work, which is last night's episode of Ride Along, which it was amazing. I think it's been the best episode so far. And it kinda actually developed characters a little bit, or maybe it's just the outside, their outside.
At least personalities.
Yeah, little bit. It invested you more in the 205 superstars.
Specifically, TJ Perkins and...
Specifically, Jack Gallagher and Brian Kendrick were in a car together for 2.5 hours, but also, Rich Swann and TJ Perkins was pretty good. Not because of TJ Perkins, but Rich Swann was pretty hilarious. But the other thing was the match with Cesaro and Jeff Hardy.
Mm-hmm.
I thought Mike brought up an interesting point yesterday about how cutting the commercial break right in the middle of the match kind of like kills the interest in the match, like all the way.
Mike, do you want to expand on that we talked about last night on the wrap up?
Yeah, it's just something I happened to, because I went to Raw last week, hence my little Nassau Coliseum shirt. I basically, like, I enjoyed last week's Raw, but when I watched it back on the USA feed, I wasn't as enthralled, because, like, it really, like, it's one thing if you have to cut, like, TNA does this, taped shows do this, like, they'll cut away for a commercial, but they'll come back basically right where they left off with the action, so you don't lose the flow of the match. Mm-hmm. But Raw, because they're a live show, they obviously can't do that. So it, you kind of lose a lot of the thread of what's going on. Because, like, if you watched last week's Raw, you didn't know the Shining Stars got offense in their eight-man tag. You didn't know they did, because all of that happened during the commercial.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I was watching it because I remembered the match, because I really enjoyed the match that I was watching. And I watched it on the commercials, and they cut to commercial, Shining Stars tag in. They get a lot of really fun offense in, and they tag out before the commercial break ends. And then it's back to Anderson and Gallus. I'm like, wow, you miss a whole moment of the match, like a whole segment of it. And it's just, I wish there were better ways to work around it. Like, there's got to be a better way to space out the matches a little bit more, even if it cuts some entrances. And I know that's, like, sacrilegious, but you don't get a lot from people's entrances sometimes.
Or put
you
more,
get more from the match.
You put more of the commercials into squash matches.
Mm.
You know, there's a good bit of filler in a three-hour show.
Joe, you're somebody that's been known to put together television before in a forum. What's your kind of take on this?
In a forum? Was that a backhanded compliment? I'm not really sure what that meant.
Sorg's been doing that all night.
In the forum. You got sassy, Sorg, tonight. I'm sorry. No, with Prime Wrestling, which was a television product that you worked on. Absolutely. You know, I mean, like there were commercial breaks and things as part of that format, right?
Yeah, sometimes not as many as we wished, but there were some, yeah.
Yes.
I mean, I think WWE does work around it as best they can. I mean, the thing you got to keep in mind is with so much technology and so many options, the WWE's thought process is they want to keep you enthralled. They want some type of hook to keep you tuning into the next segment. What's going to happen? Is the babyface going to rebound? And WWE has pretty much, from what I understand, carte blanche as far as where they put these commercial breaks. So everything's by design. If the Shining Stars got offense during the commercial break, it was because the Shining Stars were supposed to get offense during the commercial break, and we weren't supposed to see them up on offense because they weren't an integral part of the story. If the focus was on Gallows and Anderson, and Primo and Epico were basically there to take a fall or to round out a segment or whatever the case is, if they're not the focus, then the story isn't on what they do. The story is on Carl and Gallows. So I am more of a fan of keep everything contained in one segment. I only cut into a match for a commercial break when I had to, if we were very heavy on time and I had to make a cut somewhere or something like that. And that's something the Attitude Era was great for. You never busted in on a match with a commercial break. Everything was self-contained, and there was still a hook backstage or a limo pulls up or something to keep people tuned in. And they've kind of gone away from that. I think that's one of the reasons people see Raw as such a chore to watch, or so formulaic or overproduced, where you've got the heel on the outside and here comes the dive, and then we have the rapid fire camera angles, and Mike Cole says, "What's going to happen when Monday Night Raw rolls on?" And then we cut to the break and we're back with the heel and the chin lock, and we're fighting up, and now we're getting ready to go home. It's such a formula that's done to death. And then that's my big problem. I don't think anything that we're meant to think is important gets missed, but I can tell you when the break's coming 20, 30 seconds before it happens. And that to me is the issue.
Yeah. And this is a show in a kind of format that's been kind of trucking on for well over 20 years. So, I mean, is it just we've seen it so many times and it's just wearing on us?
I mean, to me, wrestling is best when it's spontaneous and you right. don't know what's going to happen or when. And it has that feel of anything can happen. And so often, Raw is such a slick show and such a perfect show that you don't get that. And as a television entity, that's amazing for them. That's what they want. As a corporate entity, that's exactly what they want to do. But it loses some of that gritty edge where, for example, if you watch Impact and they have the roaming sort of pseudo hidden camera that kind of zooms in and out and blurs in and out, at least that gives you a little bit more of an organic feel of something naturally progressing rather than a setup studio type shot that's perfectly lit and perfectly mic'd. So part of me will always go back to wanting that kind of organic and natural presentation. And again, you know, people say WWE is the McDonald's of wrestling. It is. It's very mainstream. It's not for everybody in every way, but what they're doing works. And if they want a sleek, clean product, then that's what they're getting.
I miss the second screen experience that they used to have. Like, because they used to, like, when Raw would cut to commercial, you used to be able to open the WWE app and watch the rest of the match unfolding during the commercial. So you could stay entertained throughout the whole time, and you could actually see how we got from point A to point B without Michael Cole saying, "Here's what you missed during the break." Like,
right.
I don't know why they stopped doing that, because it's not like they're not filming it.
I feel like that felt like something that they kind of supplemented with what they do on Twitter, right? On Facebook and things like that. I mean, I know it's not a specific thing, but they're providing that content and the engaging with the GIFs and everything like that, right? I think that's just where the energy went, production-wise.
Yeah. I would say, too, the network. When the network came to pass, the app kind of got downplayed.
Right.
And on top of that, I would be curious to know if there were ever any complaints from advertisers about that, kind of encouraging fans to not watch the commercials.
Is there any complaints from USA Network for telling you to go on the WWE Network app instead of sticking around for Chrisley Knows Breast?
That's a good point.
I mean, every time I see that, it's just like, yeah, right? Because I mean, how many people are going to go and watch, you know, Road, I wouldn't call it Road Rules, what the hell's the name of it?
American Ninja Warrior.
No, Ride Along, thank you.
Only Chrisley's on.
Thank you. Wonderful producer Missy.
That sounded scripted.
Yeah, say it when we're on the air. Uh-huh. Talk about overproduced and slick.
And we come full circle.
Yep. If you got to be on the Facebook Live to know what that was about. But hold on, we got some comments I need to catch up with. Or they could go to picture-in-picture mode. That's an interesting idea. They could drop a picture down while they got ads running.
They tried that. They tried that during the first live SmackDown.
Really?
During the first live SmackDown, that was a real thing. Mm-hmm. They had a picture-in-picture mode, like half commercial ad space, half action, and it was actually really good. Like, it actually kind of made me pay attention during the commercials.
Mm-hmm.
And I usually don't. Like, when the commercial hits, I tune out completely. Like, that's why I check Twitter and stuff like that. But if I know the match is still happening, I'll watch the TV.
And a good point, because we're very, very, you know, geocentric when we think about these things. But Tina's pointing out that the app, as you remember it, Mike, didn't work on those breaks because the West Coast area couldn't view it.
That's true.
Because they get it 3 hours later, despite.
Right.
They get what 3 hours later?
Raw feed. The Raw feed, if it's live. Okay, so generally,
I think there are certain channels.
West Coast.
Yeah, like you can get an East Coast feed of Raw on the West Coast, but not everyone can do that.
No, not everyone can, but generally, like, that USA Network feed is just truncated 3 hours, even though it says live. Saturday Night Live, until recently, or coming up here soon, has always been, you know, 11:35 West Coast.
It's always live on the East Coast.
Despite. So, the West Coast gets screwed a lot when it comes to live. They get the New York ball drop. at 11 or midnight in you know, local time that happened here.
But they do get ago. Like football and regular wrestling pay-per-views wrapping up at like 10 o'clock at
yeah,
night.
You can have afterwards.
I mean, yeah. That's the trade off. That's the trade off.
Man, those early games that start at like 9 AM though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, but then again, no one watches those early games anyway.
Nobody watches those early games?
No. Look what they put on those early games. No one watches.
It's all those East Coast.
You want to see the Jets versus the Jaguars? Be my guest.
That's true. There you go. Let's see. Tina's saying Xfinity had to wait till 8 p.m. She's up there, of course, in Washington State. So
speaking of ads... Mm-hmm. It seems Raw was getting like the Xyzal ad on was everywhere.
Speaking of Jeff Hardy match.
Now, once they get that type of advertisement, you have an advertising crawl or a graphic on the bottom of the screen. Now, do they get to stay on for longer? Does that advertisement provide them with the ability to keep commercials short for that segment?
Maybe.
But it is pretty funny that the Xyzal ad goes on only on screen only during Hardy matches.
I'm convinced that's the reason the New Day was traded to SmackDown, so that there wouldn't be any fuck that owl chance when they got in the ring together.
Very possible.
Oh, actually, that's a really good point.
Joe, have you seen these owl ads they've been running during Hardy matches?
I haven't, no.
So it's a CG owl. It's for an allergy medication, and they've gotten to the point where the matches, you know, they do, like, tonight on SmackDown, there was a match brought to you by Geico, right? They've been doing this a lot lately. So it's brought to you by Xyzal, is it?
Xyzal. It's XYZ.
Yeah.
Because it's, like, it covers everything from A to Z. So it's Xyzal, XYZ.
Somebody's been paying attention to the ads.
And then just, like, yeah, I have an attentive eye. Sorg.
And so they do that, and then even the bell has rung. Jeff Hardy and Cesaro are in there starting the match, and there's even they're doing a read of the ad while the match is starting. I think Corey Graves was doing it, right?
Yeah, they actually did. They read the copy
with the owl in the corner of the ring, basically.
Yep, and he stays there like the little network watermark.
Yeah,
in the corner, and he stays there for.
All joking aside, I would prefer to see that than having them actually cut to commercials.
True. You know what I mean? Which they did cut anyways for that match.
I don't like the on-air reading of the ad, though.
But I would prefer that over taking a 5-minute break from a match and then coming back and missing something.
True.
See, I'm reversed.
It's weird in the middle. Also, when you're watching a pay-per-view and your women's champion's coming out and we're promoting Hulu...
Yeah,
like
that's the only problem I have. It's because it seems like so and so, that's great. He's coming down, but have you had a stuffy nose lately? Try this medicine, and now back to the action.
Yeah, it seems weird. Yeah, it seems a little weird in place.
It's no like Jim Ross Skittles,
let
anything,
alone it being
stack or two.
Yeah.
even then, they only did that.
But man, like
not
like,
during a match.
We're talking about last night on the wrap up. Like I feel like. Like, did Xyzal have an owl mascot before the Hardys show up?
They did.
But they were not running ads on Raw.
If it wasn't for Xyzal,
it was going to be for Hooters. It was just going to be something that had an owl.
Somebody picked up the phone.
Hooters has sponsored WWE events recently.
Have they?
Exactly. Yeah.
I'd say within the past 24 months.
That would be way inappropriate.
I thought it may be one of the pay-per-views.
I believe most Hooters are still WWE blast zones to watch pay-per-views.
I think they're the only blast zones left, and they all shut down around Pittsburgh, so it gets really awkward.
It was pretty big in Dubai.
What? Really?
Seriously, in bars in Dubai, they were playing the WWE Network. Basically, it was like their version of SportsCenter. Like,
yeah, that makes
at the
sense.
Bar.
That makes sense.
Oh, that's awesome.
Okay, weird aside, but I had some, you know, Uber driving on the side, and I had a guy get in, and we picked him up from Fast of the Furious that I saw earlier in the evening. So that was fun. But we're talking about stuff, and he's from India, right? He's in town consulting or something. And we started talking about wrestling. He's like, oh, everybody loves wrestling in India, right? Like, which, you know, we've heard. Great Kali and such, right? He's like, yeah, people when they come to America have to find, like, he said something about like they have to find a WWE event, and that's like their big, like,
Yeah.
Like, you know, I have to see it in person because they see it on TV, and I don't think they don't go to India much, right? I think they've only just started going.
It's big in India mm-hmm. and Pakistan because there were there were builders where we were working, and they would get like an hour break. And they were from India and Pakistan, and during that break, they were on their phones
mm-hmm.
watching. Like, you would hear them like singing the Undertaker's music. I swear to God, they were humming.
Wait, humming Taker's music.
So like, and he wasn't even on the screen. This is just like while they're working, you hear them humming.
So this visual in my head is just a bunch of Pakistani dudes like just humming the Undertaker theme music.
Yeah, like, swear to God,
really high pitched one in the just hitting the high notes the other ones can't hit.
Seriously, man, it's big over there. It's huge over there.
I can believe that. It's almost like, I guess, how Americans would treat baseball. Like, I got to go to different stadiums to see different games, you know? Mm-hmm. And then
I was able to watch Monday Night Raw at 4 in the morning, except when golf was on. Mm-hmm. Golf trumped Raw for some reason. It pissed me off.
That's amazing. It's Larry spent 6 weeks in Dubai.
Yeah.
So you were around this a good bit, right? Yeah. So that's amazing. It's nice to know that there's something like that. Yep. I couldn't find, when I was in Thailand, I couldn't find anything wrestling. Wow. Barely anything video games. I thought I'd find something. I wanted to find something weird, Thai, WWE or something to bring home. There was big with kickboxing and stuff like that.
There was a toy store in the mall and a huge banner with John Cena on one side and Stone Cold Steve Austin on the other.
Jeez.
For all their toys and action figures and stuff.
Well, we went down a rat hole on this one. Tina's asking in the chat room, didn't they do live ad spots on one time or another? I think there was a Raw that DJT appeared in commercial free zone. There was a commercial free one where they just talked about they ate cold Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Oh, yeah, and that was probably the reason.
I mean, Joe, you have to remember that one well, right?
Oh, man, I was probably jealous at the time if they were eating KFC during wrestling.
Yeah.
God, that would be a perfect job for me.
How do you get that one right?
In lieu of paying me, any promoters listening could just give me a few chicken to munch on the entire event, and you got me. I'll do whatever you want.
At Georgia Gold.
Sorg. Hey, Sorg. You know what else would be really delicious to eat during wrestling?
That would be Slice on Broadway, our friends supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza right here in Pittsburgh. Because this is a subtle way of doing an ad in compared to wrestling. But we don't have a CGL that has weird connotations during somebody's match. We do have a shirt that says something to that effect, though. No, we had a real owl in here, so I guess we're... Yeah.
That son of a bitch.
Slice on Broadway are not sons of bitches. Check them out. They're here in Beachview or Carnegie PNC Park over the Pittsburgh Pirates.
Roll in. Hey, you guys are the not sons of bitches. Can I have a not son of a bitch piece of pepperoni, please? You're the best slice in this town.
Oh, thank you to our former sponsors, Slice on Broadway, sliceonbroadway.com, BTH_slice on the Twitter. And let them know the Mayhem Show sent you, especially this week.
So. Tell them they're not sons of bitches.
You're really not a son of a bitch.
Yeah, sons of bitches, you are not.
Oh, thank you so much, those guys supporting the show. Tina also says,
Sorg is trying to burn every bridge in Pittsburgh.
It's the night it all burns down. We got a lot of work to do.
Sorg's big heel turn.
And Sorg, it's pronounced Carnegie. Damn it!
Oh, son of a bitch! Man. Damn it, Mike.
I haven't seen a heel turn this big since James Ellsworth screwed over Dean Ambrose.
Okay, SmackDown tonight. We have the like Gal Pal gang staring down Charlotte.
The Four Horsewomen.
The Four Horsewomen and Ellsworth had like the biggest thing to say. That stuck out to me for some reason. Yeah. But
so wait, was Ellsworth their J.J. Dillon?
He was.
Wow.
He was.
That's excellent.
That seems right. Jeez. Larry, what was the third thing you wanted to talk about?
I don't remember. Oh, no, I do remember.
You can never leave Larry in charge.
It was Jericho and other Tom Phillips segment on Raw.
Yes, a friend of the show, the Drifter, has been drifting through Raw. Made two appearances last night. Mm-hmm. I'm loving this.
I still want him to drift onto other shows.
Wait, where were we?
That to happen.
What were we talking about? Like the idea of him drifting on other WWE shows or other USA Network shows?
Yes,
to all of it.
Chrisley knows best.
Yes, just all. I want him to be like at outside the restaurant that Chrisley's going to.
He's gonna be playing in the mariachi band
when they're playing Fast Five for the 18th time. I just want like the little crawl of the Drifter playing like "Move, Bitch, Get Out of the Way" on his acoustic guitar or something like that. Like,
but it was,
needs to happen.
The backstage vignettes have been getting better.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
so across the board.
Yeah, yeah,
and not just because they have their own music with the Drifter now.
It's the slow burn to introduce him.
Well, before we move on to the segments, Joe, you know, obviously, you know, Elias Sampson, the former Logan Shula, somebody you saw come up. I know he's featured on some of your Prime Wrestling stuff as well. You know, how is it to see him on that main stage? I mean, although you know so many on the main stage these days.
Yeah, yeah, there's a lot of them, but. Not many of them that I had a chance to watch grow from literally match one, like Elias Sampson.
Or setting up the ring.
Yeah, yeah. From ring crew to security staff to opening match to IWC champion to NXT to WWE. Incredibly proud of him. Very dedicated talent. Always had something special, always had a bit of a magnetism about him where he was understated verbally, but he had that presence about him where you knew that he had a chance to grow into something special.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact he's been able to not just survive, but thrive as NXT has grown into the monster that it has is a testament to him. And just seeing in his little bit of cameos he's had on television so far, that comfort level and that embracing of that persona, which, you know, is obviously much different from the heavy metal Jesus that you and I knew back in the day. He's a lot more chill, a lot more relaxed. And, you know, he's totally, I don't know if he's 180, but he's totally adapted to the role, and there's so much more depth there now. And I think the sky's the limit, man. He's got the size, he's got the look, he's got personality, and he's a homegrown creation. So this is only, as much as he's been through so far, this is the real chapter one of what Elias Sampson is going to do.
What would you say? Because even like, you know, the heavy metal Jesus thing, but like this is, it feels more in tune with what his personality was too.
Yeah. Yeah. Heavy metal, I would think of as a screamer. I would think of as very loud and in your face with the wild hair and the wild lifestyle of girls and excess and alcohol. Logan Shula wasn't ever really that. He had the musical background, but if you speak to him, he was always more reserved, more respectful, and I think this allows him to be not himself, but closer to where he's more natural. And I think the old adage of, you know, you take yourself and you turn the volume up to 11 is pretty apropos here. I don't think Logan Shula as a character ever was truly fleshed out to the potential it could have been. But I think Elias Sampson absolutely has a much better shot of doing that.
Absolutely. And he wasn't somebody, you know, again, he wasn't somebody that was, you know, NXT champion or anything like that, but he was a great character, and holy crap, he got a reaction from the fans. And I think, and I'm glad to see he's on Raw, because I think a big part of that was the story that Corey Graves would tell about him, right? In reaction. And disgust and cool Pittsburgh references that we would enjoy, right? Because like he really kind of sets him up well, I think.
He helps sell the character.
Yeah. If anybody does, you know, he's not an Enzo and Cass, right? No. Coming up, he's not a Shinsuke Nakamura coming up when everybody's like, oh god, he's here, right? Except for maybe us. But when he shows up and Graves is like, what the hell is he doing here? And like, you know,
yeah,
that sets the vibe for him. And I think that's going to set him up really well. And we'll see when he actually gets in there what they do with him. You know, I think it's going to be interesting to see that. So, rolling around, you were talking about the feel of the show last night and the backstage promos and things like that, right? Yeah. And I know, Mike, we talked about this on the wrap up last night, but I contend that like a lot of the things that we liked about SmackDown are now bleeding over into Raw and made Raw, like, this is the third week in a row that it's been a really good Raw, I think, in a lot of our opinions.
Yeah, I don't think... I think that SmackDown has seriously been a guinea pig for the last 6 months, you know, and they noticed that what they were doing over there was working. So I think they're just kind of taking that format and pushing it onto Raw also, mm-hmm. you know, slowly. But it's working. Everything's been better so far. And mm-hmm. when was the last time you had three good Raws in a row? Really? No, I mean, seriously.
Right.
You know, I can't remember within the last year.
Although, if they are going to, it is going to happen. It's usually this time of year where it does happen.
That's true.
So, but.
That's true.
Can you really count the Raw after WrestleMania, though?
I think so.
You can count it if the shows after the Raw after WrestleMania continue to be good.
I think it was genius to roll right into the Superstar Shakeup.
Yeah.
Because I like. The vibe of like, this is the new season, like, you know, that's when it needs to be. And the draft used to be around then too, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Sometimes they would have it kind of whenever, but we were talking during SmackDown. I'd love to see they do the shakeup this time of year. What if they still do a draft back? You know, when they did the draft
SummerSlam.
They can't. No.
I think they can.
That would only be in a couple of months.
It keeps things. It's 6 months from now, and it keeps things fresh. You know.
Yeah.
Because I mean, they've shown that you can't. They can't carry the same. Like, keep repeating the same storylines. Because things were starting to get dry leading up to WrestleMania. You know, like there's only so much you can do with the same characters on the same
and
show.
And so much of WrestleMania. So
why
should
not
be
stir the pot?
So much of WrestleMania should be the end of the story. Well, the internet broke, and we fixed it up, and that's us doing the hard break in the middle of the match. In the meantime, Chad hit Larry with a steel chair, and Missy super kicked the dog. But you're not going to see that now because it crashed. So, sorry, guys. Sorry, guys. We'll be right back after this message with the big question. Be sure to check out our friends, IndieWrestling.us, and click that link for the Fight TV app. Where you can check out the Welterweight Wrestling pay-per-view coming up here. We'll be right back.
Sidekick Media Services. We are your sidekick in business for social media, video production, and more. Find out more at sidekickmediaservices.com.
Hey, guys, it is the Wrestling Mayhem Show. The crew is hanging here. Producer Missy. Lovely producer Missy. Yay.
Scripted.
As well as Chad the Shad, Larry, Mad Mike, and the profound Joe Dombrowski joining us, bringing some class to the show. Thank you, sir. Check out his Welterweight Wrestling tournament coming up on the Fight TV app, iPay-Per-View, as well as Premier Championship Wrestling in Cleveland. Sorry, I'm having a confusion. I don't think this cord's plugged in. This thing's going to die. John Cohn was MVP of that ending last night. That is a good setup for this. Last night, we were talking about off-air for Gold, actually, about Braun Strowman and how amazing he is and how ring-breaky he is. So, you know, last night we got to see that collapse of the ring. John Cohn going over the side. They had a video with him online about him getting attended to. I don't know. I was just, they were coming off, and next thing I knew, I was on the floor.
he puts his hand on the rope, like, just going to take a breather here. and then the rope just loses slack. he tumbles outside the ring.
Joe, did you, I know you didn't watch like much of Raw. Did you see the ring collapse last night? And did it remind you of when Rhino toppled over the match at Resolution the one time?
Oh man, that was such a brutal day for me.
I thought you were done after that.
I always get flashbacks of that whenever I see a malfunctioning, a malfeasance of any kind of a ring. The thing that got me about Rhino and Jason Bayne at Resolution 5 was Rhino, with just being a big old steaming locomotive and nothing else, snapped a part of the ring that was there wasn't even anything wrong with it. And that was an old ring. There were some issues with it, but there was a metallic part of it, or a connector, or a cross cable, or something that completely snapped when he hit the ropes. The ring post popped out, and the ring very legitimately collapsed, and we very legitimately had a 55-minute intermission to fix it, which just added to my problems that day.
Also,
pay-per-view
too.
That was completely live, and we had to work with that. That was also the day we had a power outage right mm-hmm. before we went on. That was a pain. But yeah, I mean, anytime a ring breaks on WWE, though, it can't compare to the sheer terror and panic I felt trying to figure out how to fix this damn ring while we're live and not completely lose the crowd on all facets. But hey, everybody's talking about last night, so it seems like they got what they wanted out of it. To me, nothing's going to replace Big Show and Brock as the perpetrators of that particular spot. This is the third time they've done it on a grand scale, but people are talking, so it's worked.
Yeah, I kind of think that once you make this a possibility in your video game by just storing up a special, it kind of loses its luster a little bit. Because like, you can just do this in the video game with anyone. Like, as long as they're a super heavyweight, you can just do that to end every match. So I mean, it kind of loses its appeal a little bit, especially when they take forever to set it up.
Mm-hmm. And a good point, Brandon in the chat room saying Big Show was heavier the last two times they did this, by the way. And if you're on the video feed, I did just show the Rhino ring break for those interested in seeing how that goes. Both Joe and I are direct ringside when that went down. Okay. There's somewhere I was going to go from there. So anyways, from that, big question, which Chad came up with. Wait, did you?
It was Mike.
Okay, Mad Mike, trying to give some credit to Chad here. What was the most memorable Raw ending for you?
Can I buzz in?
And you buzz in. Buzz in.
I got the first. Vince's limo blowing up. Because of the... It's the sheer lunacy that at the time I was like, did they just blow up Vince McMahon? Like, as a wrestling fan, that storyline was interesting. And then, of course, the Chris Benoit situation happened, and Vince had to come back on air, and they just kind of never got to go wherever they were going to go with that.
Yeah.
But to have that type of seamless cut, and have that blow up like that, and just end, like, I thought that was everlasting.
Movie magic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well done.
What about you, Larry? You got one?
Just off the top of my head, Austin coming and cleaning house during Invasion from the bar. You know, when he was playing nice guy Austin and not hurting anybody.
Yeah.
And then he just, like, pulls into the parking lot with a pool cue. And then just cleans out the entire locker room.
Wow, I forgot about that.
That's just what came to the top of my head. I don't know if I have a better one if I actually think about it, but yeah, that was it.
That was a good one in here, but I think I want to take it from Tina because that was a good one, and one of my favorites is the Nexus takeover.
That was a really good one.
When they destroyed the ring, when Daniel Bryan choked, was it Justin Roberts? And got suspended for a month.
Yeah.
Man, that Daniel Bryan's never going to have a chance now. What a then we got to see
the ring apart.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, in the canvas. And...
Right. It was so, like, it felt, you know, it felt off script. It felt a surprise. It's the kind of thing that, Mike's losing it over there.
Missy just broke me. I just got a preview of what the graphic for this week's show is.
Oh, shit. oh, shit.
Oh, man.
So Mike, okay. What was your raw moment?
Mine, well, Tina mentioned it in the chat, but mine is Milkomania running wild.
That's a good
Kurt one. Kurt Angle coming out of the damn milk truck.
That's like, a good one.
Yeah, like, the best raw endings to me have that go-home line. And I'll never forget, JR said, the billion-dollar princess has just become a Dairy Queen. Can't top that. It's topical. It's a pun. It's slight promotion. Like, it's unbeatable.
Were they a sponsor at the time? I'm curious.
Probably. I assume. How many times do you see Dairy Queen commercials during Raw?
I don't know.
It's
all the time.
Was CM Punk's pipe bomb a last segment of Raw?
Yeah, it was.
That was really good,
being called out by Matt Collins in there. Brandon's calling out CM Punk stealing the title but and never coming back, but I think that was Money in the Bank.
That was at the pay-per-view.
That was at the pay-per-view in Chicago. So,
which, if we were talking pay-per-views, was a good ending.
That's a good one, yes. But Joe...
Yeah, when he blows a kiss to Vince McMahon.
Yeah. Joe, how about you?
Man, I think so many of the best endings came from the late 90s, and... Talk about the go-home lines. Jim Ross brought a lot of those things home. A lot of times I'll just remember JR screaming, you know, what's wrong with you or something like that, not even really remember what's going on. But JR's voice is still in my mind. But the one that really sticks out, what JR wasn't even there for that one, was Michael Cole, but it was Mick Foley winning the world title for the first time. Mm-hmm. And Stone Cold Steve Austin with the chair and put Mick on top and the celebration and just that feel-good moment. And I don't know, man, you got to look really, really hard to find a louder crowd reaction than for Stone Cold's run-in and for Mick's title win. And I'll throw in a dark horse as well. I don't know if it's a guilty pleasure of mine or not, but I absolutely love the episode of Monday Night Raw with Brian Pillman and the Gun.
Oh, Pillman's got a gun, yeah.
The fact that story built up throughout the show, and I remember our friend Kevin Kelly trying to explain what was happening on a remote from the house, not saying gunshots. No one was hurt by any of the explosions. He saw the gun and he left. And Lawler had lost all of his couth at that point. Has anybody been shot? He just didn't give a crap anymore. And Kevin's explaining. He saw the gun. He let, oh, my God, he's back. And Austin rushes in. And Pillman's waving the gun in his face. Pillman drops an F-bomb, uncensored, on live television that USA gets pissed about. That is oftentimes overlooked in that confusion, but just the chaos of that and how much I loved the Pillman and the early Austin characters. That whole episode is always going to be one of my favorite episodes. By the way, Sorg, did you get to say hello to Brian Pillman's son up in Meadville?
I saw him and I was like, what the heck's that guy about? And then I found out later. So was that really him? There was also speculation that it might not be him.
Who else would it have
been? I don't know. Hey, you're the one that has that thing with that one heart guy. So that's what was.
I don't have a thing with anybody.
Didn't someone get thrown into a kiddie pool during that segment too?
the gun segment? I believe.
Yeah.
I believe so. There was a kiddie pool and there was a children's tricycle.
Yes, yes. I remember there was like a whole bunch of toys on the front lawn just being used as props.
They belonged to Brian Pillman Jr.
There you go. Maybe that was his.
Austin brought it with him.
You think, yeah.
He carries a tricycle around with him everywhere.
Because why not? Matt Carlin says he recently watched the first Austin Vince match on Raw. Quotes. It is all-time great JR and King.
That's Corporate Mankind.
Oh, wow.
That was Dude Love, when Dude Love turned heel.
Right.
And that was one of those JR moments where JR is screaming off the top of his lungs, "What's wrong with you? Stop this. What are you doing?" Right. And it goes off with the crowd in a hush and JR just screaming bloody murder. And that tone and that emotion just meant so much.
Was Vince announcing Eric Bischoff a go home?
No.
That was the intro, right?
Yeah.
That was a crossover segment between the hours.
Okay.
When JR's yelling,
right, because it was Booker T saw who it was and it was like, tell me I didn't just see
what was that, Chad?
Okay. When JR is yelling at people and calling them you son of a bitch.
Anytime he was working with Heyman.
When he's yeah, like Heyman, when Joe was mentioning Heyman. when he's yelling them about calling out their characters, like, you know, you used to be an upstanding guy, you son of a bitch, why are you doing this? that does stick in your head.
That's all scripted now.
Those are good memories.
What the hell? Man, right before Austin's music hit, JR yells, "I just bought a house." What?
Well, no, because he thought Austin was going to get everyone fired.
Oh, okay. Oh, right. Tina is also saying The Dark Wedding, the one between Kane and Lita, I believe we're talking about there.
No, that was Taker and Steph.
Was that The Dark Wedding?
That was Taker and Steph, where Austin came in and saved Stephanie McMahon despite his better interests. Like, he was doing it for Stephanie even, and not doing it for Vince.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
that was really, really good.
Yeah,
that was the whole higher power thing.
Yep.
An honorable mention that helped launch this show: Live Sex Celebration.
Live Sex Celebration.
Yep. That was the
you can catch our reactions on episode 1 of Wrestling Mayhem Show.
That was a go home, wasn't it?
No, yeah. I thought the end of that show was Edge versus Ric Flair.
No, that was the end.
That was the ending.
Yeah, that was the end. Edge was barely clothed. I don't think he wrestled after that.
Unless
Cena interrupted the segment.
Unless crazy Ric Flair ran out there to join in.
I think that was a go home.
I'm pretty sure it was.
Is it on?
Edge was only champion for 3 weeks during that run. So.
Yeah. But it was a wonderful 3 weeks.
You can go back and get our thoughts on episode 1 of Wrestling Mayhem Show.
Yep, go back in the archive. Wrestling Mayhem Show Classic.
566 episodes ago?
What are we at? I don't even know anymore. So on that note... Jeez. We were going to talk to Joe about something. So Joe,
a segue and a half.
Yes. I don't know what do I do with that? What do I do with that? So Joe, you got of course, the Welterweight Wrestling tournament here coming up. But it's again, something, you know, you don't see people that late in WWE for the most part, right?
For the most part. Yeah. There's a couple in the cruiserweight division, but by and large, the business is always going to be cosmetic, and people want size and people want larger than life. And even though the average size in wrestling has skewed smaller than it ever has been before, I think there's still some sort of stigmatization there where, all right, you're not going to have a 170-pound guy be able to stand next to a 230-pound guy and have it be the most believable thing in the world.
Mm-hmm.
But there are absolutely a myriad of talents out there just developing, still coming up, still in their 20s, that are going to grow into themselves, that are still going to wind up getting bigger and filling out more. But right now, they absolutely still have something to offer, just because they're not global TV ready doesn't mean they can't go and doesn't mean they can't entertain the hell out of you. And I think that's a niche, and that is a platform that has been shockingly completely overlooked by the independents.
Mm-hmm.
There's no home specifically for those type of athletes, even though so many independents showcase a cruiserweight type style. There's no place that builds around, well, let's not just do one wrestling style. Let's do a body type, or let's do a style of performer, but not necessarily a style of performance.
Mm-hmm.
Let's give you something that hammers a niche hard, but still can give you variety and difference throughout the night. And I think that's the goal with this welterweight wrestling. It's let's hit that niche button hard, but let's make sure that no matter what kind of fan you are, there's something in here that you can enjoy.
And of course, you know, some of that, you know, people think about the 205 Live, and we're going to have even a women's wrestling tournament on WWE Network here. I think in the summer they've announced, right?
Yeah.
And obviously Larry is a big fan, as he watches during the show and informs us on 205 Live. Let me know what I'm going to see later tonight. And we were talking about a little bit off air, like, you know, Kalisto being in a weird. It seems like he's always in the wrong place.
He's in limbo.
He's in a weird 205 Live, tossed in a dumpster last night mode for some reason. This is something that, you know, it seems that, you know, the 205 Live guys have flourished, where I don't think, you know, on a Raw or something by themselves, intermingled with everybody, they just would have been the fodder, right?
Yeah.
In the long run, you know, how important is that for people in these, you know, size types and everything, to have those kind of platforms to flourish, where maybe they wouldn't on a, you know, heavyweight, you know, up against a Braun Strowman or something on the main shows?
Well, I mean, that's the problem. I think that's something that the easiest way to bury a cruiserweight division or bury a light heavyweight division or anything like that is to put them against the heavyweights. You want to keep them mutually exclusive. You don't want to see them get beat up constantly week after week. And the thing is my problem with the cruiserweight division is that it is conditioning the audience that these talents are less than, or they're different than, and they're not going to be given an ample platform to get themselves over under the WWE umbrella. They've never known how to do a cruiserweight division or a light heavyweight division. They tried it when WCW was flourishing with it. They tried it up into the Shane Helms era and Billy Kidman and Chavo Guerrero. And it was always a low middle card filler. And it still is the low middle card filler. Austin Aries is over. Jack Gallagher is over. Rich Swann, TJ to an extent, but there's so many guys that just haven't given a chance to explain who and what they are.
Mm-hmm.
And you put that against a Raw segment or against a SmackDown crowd after a live SmackDown, and the indifference is very noticeable, and that hurts things. If they had their own platform, be it at a Full Sail, be it at an ECW arena type environment, where they could feed off of that energy, I think that would go a lot further, because there's nothing wrong with the talent. They mm-hmm. have amazing talent, but I don't think the presentation is as good as it can be. And I think the concept is antiquated, because I don't see a need for a cruiserweight weight class in 2017. I would have taken the U.S. title when it was on Kalisto, before he went on commentary and they lost faith in him. I would have taken Kalisto, I'd have taken Neville, I'd have taken whoever else I wanted to take, and just build the U.S. title as the WWE's version of an X division. Let's not have a weight limit. Let's not have restrictions and parameters. Let's let these guys go out and do what they do, and let's just build that style around that championship. That to me is the use of a cruiserweight in 2017, where contrast that with what I'm trying to do with a welterweight. These are the guys that wouldn't get a chance to get to that point to begin with. So let's give them a chance on an even keel playing field. No heavyweights on the show. Mm-hmm. No heavyweights to be seen. This is all their time to shine and their time to make the most of their opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think if maybe the cruiserweights were moved to SmackDown instead of being on Raw, that the SmackDown audience might get a little bit more exposure to who they are, like maybe have the one sampler match on SmackDown as opposed to on Raw, and that way they can be like, oh, we just saw this guy earlier, like, and they can kind of get into it instead of...
I don't think the audiences are altogether different between Raw and SmackDown. I think there's always going to be healthy crossover, there's always going to be healthy talent that or healthy amount of fans who are just there because wrestling's in town and they really aren't that familiar with specific talent. What it comes down to is, after I've seen Randy Orton and Bray Wyatt and John Cena and all the heavy hitters, and emotionally I've been brought up to, you know, hopefully brought up to a 10 or 11 on the scale, anything after that's going to be a drop down. Anything after that high point of SmackDown is going to feel like an emotional letdown. You have nearly impossible elements to follow, and you're providing something that is a niche product that is inherently not going to be what, you know, the single mom with three kids or whatever may be there to see. They're there to see their superheroes, not necessarily see the
Akira Tozawa.
Yeah, because again, what's Akira Tozawa doing that AJ Styles and Seth Rollins can't do? And that's not a knock on Akira Tozawa, but I would love to see Akira Tozawa work with AJ and work with Seth Rollins, and then I think people care a lot more about Akira Tozawa. But I think they've been conditioned for so long that this is the C show or this is the C division, that it's only going to get so big. And I think if guys like Aries continue to be hot, they'll be plucked from the division and placed onto the main shows, just like the X Division guys and Impact were plucked from that division and put on top of the cards.
Well, I think if nothing else, the 205 is like giving you a reason to watch the matches on Raw more. You know, like instead of them being just filler matches with no storyline whatsoever, it's giving you a little bit more.
But I think the thing missing is when now on Raw it feels like, you know, the cruiserweights aren't having the better matches on Raw, they're having the better matches on their own 205 Live show, right?
Right, but it's progressing the storyline a little bit, right? You know what I mean, as opposed to just throwing them in there.
But is that enough? Are they doing enough on Raw to make you want to watch that 205 Live show? Now I think those are into 205 Live, and some of us saw in person when they were here in Pittsburgh. I felt like the crowd was fairly into it. I think some of the matches they've had in recent weeks have been really killer.
Yeah.
I mean, the kids love doing the Tozawa scream. You know,
they love dancing to Rich Swann.
Yeah, I mean, the characters
still there.
The characters are popping up. But yeah, I thought I would see a mass exodus.
There was a lot of people at the Pittsburgh show.
There was a lot of people that stuck around. Oh, they did leave.
They did leave.
But
I mean, there was a good bit that stayed, but I mean, from the
it's
SmackDown
also a
transition.
Tuesday night, 10 p.m. So yeah,
it's tough. It's tough. That's why we were like,
"What was the advertised dark match?"
Ambrose and Corbin.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's not necessarily
they never did
a draw for a lot of people to stay.
Also, live, they never really did a good job telling people in the arena that 205 Live was going to be happening.
No, they just said it like the last minute.
They were just like, "Hey, 205 Live is coming up." They never like said, "Hey, stick around. Hey, we got more wrestling for you. Hey, we got this. We got."
But they did do the
if
pyro.
If you went there and didn't know about 205 Live, you would have left.
That's true. The most you would get
I'm surprised. Surprised because like during the commercial breaks, why aren't they showing like highlight reels from 205 Live?
Yeah.
To get people amped for it, that makes the most sense to me.
Some character like some character packages like who is Akira?
Yeah, character packages, like matches, like match highlights, stuff like that. Like, that makes the most sense to me instead of showing the same, oh, we've had this many celebrities at WrestleMania package over and over again.
And maybe even slight package, like, hey, over the past weeks, this is what's been happening on 205 Live. Mm-hmm. You know, just like a sizzle reel and saying,
right,
hey,
right,
this is when it's on.
There are previews during SmackDown, and maybe they're thinking that's enough. But I think in the key people there and into it, but those that are there are into it, and I think it's a fair number. Some points from the chat room here. Tina's out there saying it depends on who kids can identify with in their characters. Her son liked TJP just due to the character, you know, play with the video games, right? It makes sense. Again, Akira, I think, is getting over with the kids, too. Gallagher is an interesting, colorful character, right? But then he had a killer match, you know, last week on 205 Live. So, yeah, I think they're doing the right things, and they're doing better than I thought in the atmosphere they would be doing, right?
Yeah.
I mean, they really just need to keep delivering on just killer shows the way that they have.
Yeah, I mean, it's never gonna be a SmackDown. It's never gonna be a Raw, and I don't think it's ever meant to be. And I honestly, I don't see it discrediting the wrestlers. You know,
mm-hmm.
I mean, if that's the direction they're going with, where weight and size actually matters in the wrestling matches now, where it didn't necessarily before, then I mean it adds credibility to it.
So no more, you know? Giant killer Rey Mysterio.
Yeah,
right?
Rey Mysterio's not going to beat the Big Show.
Yeah. Yeah, I like it. Well, meanwhile, hey, speaking of... No, I have no transition. I'm not going to try because they're all demeaning tonight by accident, so we're just not going to go there. And I'm not going to do it for this one.
So you're just going to blatantly disrespect transitions like that,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah, you know.
What do you have against transitions, Sorg?
Jeez. Not saying anything. No, I wanted to give a shout-out because, of course, I don't know if we talked on the show last week what happened with DJ Z in Mexico. You know, he was...
We did, didn't we?
I think we might have. Just an update. He's up walking around. If you want to kind of an update on what's going on, his Facebook page, his personal Facebook page, has been, he's been some updates. He's been up walking around and spending some good quality time in Mexico City, apparently. And there's, I got to share this. He came across a light tube cage.
What is this?
Battle Royal match on the streets? Hold on. You're watching an intergender light tube steel cage match in the streets in front of a handful of people on a Saturday afternoon, only in Mexico.
Hashtag feminism.
Yeah, there you go.
I think he's kicking himself for not being in that match.
I don't think he's missing the light tubes at all. But also, if you want to really catch up on what's going on over there, like, share, subscribe to his YouTube channel. And DJ Z Fake Fights and Misflights Episode 6, which does detail and kind of recap exactly what happened with the incident in Mexico City. And I didn't realize this. I think I discovered this afterwards, Mike, that we did the show last week. The show that he was on was actually a TNA kind of cross band show that they're doing down there with the appropriately named The Crash show down there. So it looked like they were kind of doing an interesting thing down there. It was a comic.
Were they giving back the Crash tag titles?
Actually, no. This first one is really interesting. Because it's a Lucha Libre Last, which was a comedy Lucha Libre show that they did in a theater down there. And there's his pants getting pulled down. Yeah, I know. It was like a weird crossover kind of thing. And then, of course, there's footage and everything from the Crash show.
Can I review that instead of Impact?
Yeah, maybe you'd do a little better with that. A lot of Lucha fun going on there.
The Crash thing is very similar to like New Japan and...
I think DDT was involved in this. It was DDT. Mexican and
I mean probably Conan. TNA. I'm sure Conan's involved in that.
I think Conan is involved in that. So it was interesting.
One of those like TNA cross things that like Noah likes to do and New Japan likes to do.
Telling how CMLL did Fantascomania in New Japan and stuff like that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So check that out. Check out his YouTube channel. He's doing a great job there with his personal blog and everything like that. So
he's recovering.
He's doing great. There was like an 80% chance of him being able to make it, or he would have been rolling with a colostomy bag. you know, basically the rest of his life.
Well, tell him not to drink the water.
I think he knows about the water.
that could be really
he's
bad
kind
for
of
him.
He's kind of been there a few times, so I think he's got that.
He's seasoned.
He's seasoned to the Mexico City. Or maybe he's just like over the water at this point, right? I think the water's the worst of his problems at this moment. So there was a picture of his scar. He also put a t-shirt. You want to support him because he's not going to be wrestling for a little bit. He's got a t-shirt, Chicks Dig Scars, TJZ, so on his pro wrestling tees page. So give him a support there. Hey, there were some more answers to the big question I wanted to get out there before we get to the go-home here. Where'd it go? Yes, Money Crushing Vince as a Raw ender.
Yeah, I didn't remember what this one was. We'll put a link in.
Yeah,
the million dollar.
Yeah, the million dollar night. Where the stage collapsed on him. I can't even remember why they did that.
I don't remember that.
How many weeks in a row did we have Vince almost getting killed?
That's true too.
Yeah,
that's true too. Then there was another one from Twitter. Dave,
ProfPod. Yeah,
ProfPod on Twitter. He says CM Punk returns after Cena wins the vacated title from Rey Mysterio.
Oh yeah,
closing that loop there. So,
awesome, and they had the two WWE titles.
Oh, and we got another ending from Brandon. They're still rolling in. Triple H got left laying by the good guy because why?
Evolution was off that night.
Okay. Yeah. All right, guys, what'd you learn from wrestling this week? Anyway, no educational moments from this week.
I learned you don't want to become Braun's pet.
Sorry, Callisto.
You just don't want it to happen. If Braun starts grabbing you by the head, I'm pretty sure the best bet is to lie perfectly still, and he'll think you're a throw rug.
Is it like a bear? Like, did you just like curl up in a ball if you see him coming?
No. You can't curl up in a ball because then they'll bat you around. You just have to lie perfectly still and don't move.
And hope they're not hungry.
Hope they're not hungry.
Hope they're not hungry.
Larry, what'd you learn from wrestling this week?
Oh, geez. I don't know. It was a good show. I don't know.
Show or Raw or what?
Oh, Raw. I mean, SmackDown was...
Oh, so you're saying our show wasn't a good show, Larry?
I see how it is. That's fine.
Sorg was a real downer.
Sorg was implying that.
He's been a real tyrant behind the scenes, man.
I learned that Sorg can be very demeaning.
If you guys out there could hear what he's saying to us in these headsets, man.
Yeah, it's like Vincent Kennedy, yelling at me.
There's one microphone.
We're all gonna quit like Mauro did, unfortunately.
Oh,
Sorg is just bullying everyone.
Oh. Mauro, call
him. Wait till you read Eamon's tell-all novel about Sorg.
He's very quit.
He did quit.
Yeah, and he's pulling pot shots at WWE on MMA commentary, apparently.
Really?
Yeah, because he's allowed to say pro wrestler now. So there's that.
I didn't know he quit.
Yeah. He's been gone.
Oh yeah, he's gone.
Yeah.
He's gone.
But yeah, that's been a whole other thing. Chad,
that's too bad.
I learned that Braun Strowman has a bright future.
Holy crap. How many
he's consistently gotten better and better as the weeks have gone by. He's got it in the ring. He did a kip up.
Again.
He was chain wrestling with the Big Show in the main event.
What is this world?
I like his.
And he better beat Roman Reigns at Payback.
I like his demeanor of like I can throw people in stretchers off of loading docks. I can throw people in the trash. He can flip ambulances. I can beat up anybody I want at any time I want.
I'm wondering if
I really like the direction he's going, and I really think when it comes down to it, like him and Brock are really gonna have a decent rivalry if he does do a thing with a program with Brock. I like the idea of Brock and Braun.
I think it's fascinating that people are booing Roman so much for getting such a fast push. You know, for, you know what I mean? Like skipping the IC title and all that stuff, and they're booing the shit out of him.
Mm-hmm.
And then here comes Braun, 6 months in the business, and they're pushing him way hard.
And it's that argument. If Roman got the push when Batista got the push that one time,
yeah,
I think it'd be a different story. But it was like it was too long. And
you also have to remember with Roman, like, they were, I think they were on the right path to doing something correct with Roman, but then he got injured for 6 months. He got injured, and then they tried to pick him back right where they left him, and that was the huge mistake.
Yeah.
That was the mistake. That's where everyone started to turn on him. Like,
so just the momentum.
Yeah. It wasn't like they eased him back in. Like, like Roman Reigns, you kind of have to have some storyline lubrication to have that work better.
We got to find out a different way to put that.
Yeah, I know. I was trying to. It has to be eased in, basically.
Joe Dombrowski, what did you learn this week?
Oh, man. Well, from what little I saw, I relearned that I always enjoy a good Fit Finley cameo on Monday Night Raw.
Yes!
Absolutely.
That's always great to see, and stealing the segment whether he wants to or not by shouting out if Goldie is okay. From my personal endeavors, I learned that you shouldn't piss off J-Rock, because if you go to my Facebook, I get chewed up and cursed out in front of a large group of people, and that video has been posted. And also learned of the tragedy that we learned today of Rosie. Matt Anawahi. So I want to give a shout out to him and the Samoan family and wish them the best. Matt, of course, Roman Reigns' brother, Sika's other son, and had some very entertaining times with 3 Minute Warning and with the Hurricane, and had a good run for what it was. And, you know, just wish you could have hung around a little bit longer, both in the ring and on the earth. But from everything I've heard, just a complete class act and a quality human being. So he'll be missed by those that love him.
Certainly. I can't follow that up now. Jeez. Had a goofy one.
Probably going to say something mean.
We should just skip it because you're just
skip me.
Sorg, you learned you need to be nicer to your producers. That's
and talent.
That's what Sorg learned.
Okay. Oh. Hi. what was my thing? Oh, well, my first inkling of Braun Strowman this week was that he's beating up everybody that the internet has a problem with.
Yeah.
Think about that hit list a little bit.
I need to bring Ryback back. Sorry.
Ryback. Brandon learned that, that's another ending. He learned that music makes anything better no matter where you are, I believe, referring to the Drifter backstage. Matt Clarence learned that the only thing holding those WWE rings together are those LED light boards.
That's true.
That's apparently true.
Those LED boards are load-bearing.
Yes, they are.
Were they on there for that match?
No, yeah, they were not.
They weren't? They took them off?
They were not.
You're no,
right.
They
weren't.
Yes.
They weren't.
They were not on there.
If you go back and look, you can see that there's just the silver pole with the red sticker on it.
It's
like when you first notice that Kane's pyro is set up on the turnbuckles, and then you can't ever not see.
Right.
It.
Yeah.
Right. If you go back, I don't know when they changed it. If it was, I didn't go back and look to see if. If they were like that in any segment before theirs, or
well, that just killed the illusion.
Actually happened, but
I'm gonna have to.
But did you notice? Did you notice while you were watching it all? Then
it doesn't matter. I have to boo. I have to boo Braun now.
Well, to be fair, we've had those LED boards way less longer than we've had non LED boards and just regular poles. So
this is true. This is true. I'm pulling this up now. The top 10 from this week. I'm curious about this. I can't believe. That's what we did. Oh, well, anyways. And I think that's all from the chat. Yes. Thank you, Joe Dombrowski, for joining us. Check out, tell people where, when, and how they can check out your thing.
My thing is called Welterweight Wrestling. It is live on internet pay-per-view. You can download the Fight app or visit fight.tv and join us on a pay-per-view basis. Sunday, May 7th, 5 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time. If you order just once for one low price, you get unlimited lifetime replays. Or you can join us live and in person at Turner's Hall on Guthrie Avenue in Cleveland, Ohio. You can check out the talent amounts, the card, and a whole lot more information. The Welterweight Wrestling t-shirt that I'm wearing and a whole lot more is available at welterweightwrestling.com, facebook.com/welterweightwrestling, at welterweightpw on the Twitter, and Welterweight Wrestling on the Instagram. So between all that, you can get your welterweight fix. And check out facebook.com/premierchampionshipwrestling as well. DCW Cleveland on Twitter. That is the standard events we're doing up in Cleveland. And, of course, my website is joe-dombrowski.com. All the documentaries, DVDs, merchandise, schedule, results, and a whole lot more. My social media is there. You can find me and do whatever you wish to me.
Ah, don't put that out there on this show.
Not with this crowd.
By the way, I did some... Thank you, Raw Top 10, because the LEDs were not out the entire night.
Really?
There you go.
Really. They're showing pieces of matches from throughout the night, and there are no LEDs. Wait, is there any on the front?
Probably not.
Probably not. I need to check that now.
Now, if they would have kept the LEDs and they sparked up...
Oh, that would have been great.
Oh, there would have been shrapnel going into the crowd.
Yeah. Hear that? Or the LEDs they just had caution signs flashing.
Yes, exactly.
I wish the front LED board on Raw was sentient.
Straight to 404 live.
It could be the next Raw general manager. There's definitely not LEDs on the front at the end. Wow. None of us noticed that?
Nope.
The end, I noticed.
Nobody called that out on Twitter or anything like that. Like, hey, where'd all the cool stuff go?
Jeez. I mean, as soon as they announced it was
no LEDs, what the hell?
As they announced it was Braun versus Big Show, I knew what was going to happen.
Mad Mike 4883 on the Twitter.
That is correct, Sorg, and we will be doing the Midweek War later this week. Also, check out 32 Manias of Mike. I watched all 32 WrestleManias and did podcasts on each one of them, so you don't have to if you don't want to.
No, and we have some fun on there as well. You don't have to watch Impact in order to enjoy the Impact recap.
No, please don't watch Impact.
It's not recommended at all, actually. Chad the Shad on the Twitters.
Yes, that's where you can find me and my musings. I have not many things going on.
Mutilator Larry is where you won't really see Larry talking much on the internet.
If you see anything on my Twitter page, I apologize. I'm firing the person who's running it at the moment. And
it's a bad night.
I'll be putting out ads on Craigslist for a new Twitter person shortly.
Someday he'll have something to promote, I'm sure.
Hopefully.
Maybe?
Hopefully. Most of my tweets are hockey related right now.
Yes, and I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitter. Check out SorgatronMedia.com. A lot of great stuff going on there. Our friend Panel Riot DJ Lunchbox, some call him Will, he had an interview on Awesome Chat last week. Find out what he's been doing since he's been gone from the Wrestling Mayhem Show. He left the Wrestling Mayhem Show. He names names, if there are names to name.
It's
awesome.
Sorg's fault.
AwesomeCast.com. Check out that and his Panel Riot podcast and so many more coming on board the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Thank you, everybody in the chat room joining us. Brandon, Carlin's, Wheels, Tina, everybody that's popped in throughout the night. Live.WrestlingMayhemShow.com if you want to join the live stream or just follow the Facebook page at Wrestling Mayhem Show. And please join that Wrestling Mayhem Show group for some great discussions. Thank you, everybody, being active in there lately. I've been seeing a lot of great stuff come up. So thank you so much, guys. And thank you to producer Menace. Mayhem Show out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com.